One thing that we want to do at Penn State is we want to be a little bit different than every other football team. We're not interested in being just part of the pack. We want to be a little bit better than everybody. And we try to sell that to our kids. We want to be unique. We want to be different. That's one of the reasons we wear those lousy-looking uniforms and we wear those black shoes, because we want to be different. We want our kids to feel that they're different and they're a breed apart, if you want to put it that way. And I think the 79 season was particularly disappointing as you look at these 3 years, because of the fact that we didn't really play with the kind of style that Penn State fans are used to, or the kind of style that I think Penn State football is all about. But as the 79 kind of gets behind us, you'll see 80 and 81 where we played great football and where kids were positioning themselves, young people, young football players, the Warners and the Blackledges and the Jacksons, to make a shot at a national championship team.
For almost 100 years, Penn State has been a symbol of excellence in college football. Typical of that tradition has been the last 10 years. Hello, I'm Jimmy Cefalo. Welcome to Volume 2 in our series, Great Moments in Penn State Football. Along with head coach Joe Paterno, we'll relive the years 1979 through 1981. During those years, the Nittany Lions won three bowl games, twice posted 10-2 records, and finished number 3 in the national rankings. Three Lions were named All-Americans, four were picked in the first round of the NFL draft. But at the start of those 3 years, the Lions were rebuilding. Coach?
79 season is one I really don't particularly like to talk about. I think that's probably the year I did the poorest job I've ever done coaching. We had just come off the 1978 season where we had a legitimate shot at a national championship, and we had lost to Alabama in the Sugar Bowl in a very exciting but a very frustrating game for Penn State and for me particularly, because we had a chance to win it and didn't score on a goal line situation when Alabama made a great stand. So we came into the 79 season, and I don't know whether I had really recovered yet from 78. And I didn't coach with a lot of enthusiasm and what have you. We were rebuilding a football team. We had a lot of young players coming in 79. We had the Kurt Warners and some of those people, but we also had a couple of great players still coming back, Clark, Millen, and some other people, but we just didn't seem to be able to get the combination right. Started out well against Rutgers when Warner, as a freshman, gained over 100 yards in the first game he was in, and he obviously proved right then and there, or at least he indicated he was going to be a super back, as he turned out to be over the next 4 years.
Warner, the freshman, is in the game. This is Warner from Wyoming, West Virginia.
Oh, back.
Later in the same drive, the freshman put the Lions ahead with a 7-yard run.
This is Warner. Touchdown.
Watch Warner on this. You know, I asked Joe about this kid. He gave me a kind of a sly smile when he used to steal my cucumbers, but did this kid go?
Not only did Kurt Warner rush for 100 yards that day, he also returned kickoffs for 109 yards and caught passes for 71.
He's got
Warner!
Bye-bye, baby!
Fantastic!
Penn State went on to win 45-10.
And then we got our Texas A&M came up to our place, and Dickey and they manhandled us a little bit, which had happened to us with Kentucky back in 1976. same kind of game. They were tougher than we were. They were quicker. They were better organized. And Dickey made a couple of super runs in that particular football game.
Curtis Dickey's first super run came on the 10th play of the game.
Here comes the before-mentioned Dickey. Look out! I don't think anybody can catch him. This might go all the way unless Walsh can get him. Whoop! The official blocked out Walsh, but I don't think Walsh could have caught him.
With the score tied in the second quarter, Penn State's defense moved to take command of the game.
Mosley to pass on first down, being rushed. Somehow he gets out of it, but not the second time. Bruce Clark made the play.
But on the next play, the Aggies slipped away.
He's going to try it again. Here comes Clark. And he has it. No, he gets out of it. This Mosley is some kind of an athlete. And he has very close to a first down.
And three plays later, Texas A&M took the lead. The Aggies went on to upset the Lions 27-14. The following week, it was out to Nebraska for a game against the Cornhuskers. Things started out well for Penn State, thanks to quarterback Dale Tate and tight end Brad Scoville. Later in the first quarter, Lion cornerback Tom Wise saw an opportunity to step in front of a Nebraska receiver. His 30-yard interception return gave Penn State a 14-0 lead. But in the second quarter, Nebraska's offense got into high gear, scoring four touchdowns with some spectacular plays.
Fake to the fullback. This is intended for Junior Miller. Touchdown! This is Brown. Touchdown!
We really got manhandled 42-17, and really the score was not indicative of how badly we were beaten. They were just nice to us.
At Maryland the next week, Joe Paterno made a tactical move. Opposing offenses had frequently been able to double-team both of Penn State's All-American defensive tackles, Bruce Clark and Matt Millen. So Clark was switched to nose guard.
We felt by moving Clark in at nose guard, we'd have a better opportunity to let him play from sideline to sideline and not just one side of the football. And it turned out very well. I think we held Maryland to maybe one first down the first half and had a good win. It was a good win for us.
Booker Moore scored twice in the Lions' 27-7 victory. Homecoming 1979 was Matt Suey's day. The senior fullback rushed for 225 yards to lift Penn State to an easy 24-3 victory over Army.
Matt Suey was probably one of the most underrated backs we ever had at Penn State. And sometimes I think back to the Army game when he had ran for 225 yards. He ran over people, around people, had speed. He was really the prototype of a fullback, I think, in modern-day football. He could run over you, he could outrun you, he could catch a football, and he did it all that day against Army.
The Carrier Dome was still under construction, so Syracuse was playing its home games at the Meadowlands of New Jersey. Against the Orange defense geared to stop runners like Suey, Penn State went to the air. Dale Tate had his best day of the year, 14 of 18 passes for 199 yards and three touchdowns. Penn State won 35-7. Twice during the 1979 season, two Penn State running backs each rushed for over 100 yards in the same game. One of them was fullback Matt Suey. The other was tailback Booker Moore.
Booker Moore was always on the fringe of going to be a great back. We put him at tailback, put him at fullback, and he had so much explosiveness, but he was not a smart runner. In the West Virginia game, he had a couple of big plays, and he did very, very well in that game, but we were never able to get him consistent at the tailback spot, and eventually ended up being an outstanding fullback and turned out to be a number one draft pick as a fullback. But he had a great game against West Virginia.
Moore gained a career-high 166 yards and scored three touchdowns on 18 carries as Penn State picked up its fourth straight victory, 31-6.
One of the more interesting games of the 79 season was our game against Miami. They beat us. And Jim Kelly, who was a freshman from East Brady, Pennsylvania, was the guy who beat us because Kelly turned out to be one of the great college quarterbacks and then probably going to be one of the great pro quarterbacks of all time. Kelly, we had had at camp, at summer camp up here, and we knew he had a great arm, but he was a big, strong kid, and There were a lot of quarterbacks around that year, and I made a very dumb statement to him. I said, hey, Jim, if you can't play quarterback, you could always play linebacker for us. Not with the idea that we didn't think he was a quarterback prospect, but with the idea that he had some options, because he was a good defensive player in high school. That was all I had to tell Kelly. Jim had no interest in even anybody thinking about him as a defensive play. Wanted to be a quarterback, and he was right. And he had a great day against us, coming home to Pennsylvania and the whole bit. And he ran the ball, he threw the ball, he did everything, and they gave us good luck.
Kelly completed 18 of 30 passes that day for 280 yards and 3 touchdowns. The Penn State ground game churned out 248 yards, but 4 costly turnovers left the Lions on the short end of a 26-10 final score.
One of the greatest and luckiest wins I have ever been involved in was when we beat North Carolina State 9-7 that year.
Both Clark and Millen were out of the lineup with injuries, but the Lion defense still held North Carolina State scoreless until the final 2 minutes of the game.
Smith keeps. Does he score?
Yes.
Yes. Scott Smith scores with 1:18 left in the game.
Well, Ray, they have to get the ball pretty much up to about the 35, 40-yard line on this kickoff return. Then they got in a position to get a couple of sideline cuts, to get a couple of first downs, and possibly kick a game-winning field goal.
A 3rd-and-8 play. This is a first down to the 41-yard line for Brad Scoville. That stops the clock, the first down, until the officials declare it ready for play. Penn State going with their 2-minute drill. They will not take any time here for a huddle.
3 plays later, it was 4th down and 24.
The clock starts. This is for Rakowski, and he has it for a first down at the North Carolina State 37-yard line. That stops the clock with 11 seconds remaining.
We threw a pass. They'll take through a pass. We had no timeouts left. Fortunately, the kid dropped the football, because when he dropped the football, it stopped the clock with 8, 10 seconds. I forget how much time was on the clock. And I didn't know what to do. I really didn't. It was going to be a 54-yard field goal. Herb had never kicked one that long, and I looked around, and there was Herb standing right next to me. He said, hey, give me a shot, give me a shot. I said, go ahead, Herb, let's see what you can do.
This will be a 54-yard attempt by Menhart out of a hold by Gooman. 1 second left. It is
good. He did it. How about it? Mama, you had the beads out today. Wow.
Fantastic finish. We didn't deserve to win it, but we won it. But Herb, just that was one of the greatest kicks, one of the greatest clutch plays that I've ever been around.
Temple quarterback Brian Brumell had the best efficiency rating in the country. But when the Owls came to Beaver Stadium, the Lions sacked Brumell 5 times. He completed only 4 of 16 passes. Penn State quarterback Dale Tate was hurt in the first quarter, but the Lions put together a running game that gained 270 yards and a 22-7 victory.
We ended up the season getting licked badly by Pitt in a game where we really didn't do much. We had a long run by Matsui, and we had a long kickoff return by Kurt Warner. But other than that, we didn't do, we just were poor. We had no consistency, no cohesion with our offense. Defensively, we were all over the place. We had never gotten into a defensive scheme that we were comfortable with. But I felt bad about it, because we had some tough kids. We had Jones and Kugler and some of those guys who were good, tough, young football players. And I never quite got to them and never did a very good job for them. So in a sense, that season was as frustrating as any season I've ever been involved in at Penn State. We ended up on a decent note. We played Tulane down in the Liberty Bowl. And we won that football game, but there again, we were not a great football team down there. We were tough and tenacious, and we played with some pride and some commitment, but we were not a great team, and But that season taught a lot of us some things about what we had to do in order to stay closer to our squad. And I think as a result of 79, we're in pretty good position to make a move in the next 3 years.
...1979 was the debut year of Kurt Warner. The freshman gained 1,013 yards on rushing, receiving, and returning kickoffs, and he would go on to have 18 100-yard rushing games in his college career. Penn State won every one of those 18 games, but Warner was only part of a long tradition of great backs at Penn State.
We've been very fortunate at Penn State that we've had great players in just about every position, but when you start talking about the glamour position, the running back, I don't know whether anybody's had better backs than we've had. When you go back, and I go back to Lenny Moore here in the middle 50s, and Lenny was a superb running back. Lenny may have been, if we were playing the I formation, and he carried the ball 20 times a ball game, he might have rushed for 2,000 yards in college, particularly if we had played 11 and 12 games. In those days, we played 9 games. Lenny averaged, I think, 8 or 9 yards a carry. Gained, just was fantastic, only carried the ball 12, 13, 14 times a football game. And I think he proved that when he was the number one draft pick of the Baltimore Colts and helped the Colts win a couple of national football championships. Franco Harris was a beautiful, aesthetic kind of football player in the sense that his stride, the way he did things, he was pretty to watch. We used to have a saying around here, if we get Franco in the secondary, we get a touchdown. And that's about the way it went. We never played a big football game, a tough football game, when Franco was healthy, that he didn't make a long run for us when we got him in the secondary. He had a great gift of knowing where everybody was when he got in that secondary. I think Lydell Mitchell was as good an all-around football player as we ever had. He may not have been quite as explosive as a guy like Kurt Warner or Lenny Moore or what have you, but he could catch, he could block, he could run inside, he could run outside. He had the NCAA touchdown record for a season for a long, long time until I think Rozier broke it. But he was a coach's player. He was great ability, but a great competitor and a guy that you could get him fired up. Could be very emotional, great leadership qualities. He was, you mentioned Lydell Mitchell, and I really get nostalgic. John Cappelletti was obviously not only a great football player, but a great person. A very, very strong leader, very warm person, who never took himself very seriously. I think he realized that God had given him a lot of ability, good mind, great family, was determined to get the most he could out of what he had been given, worked very hard, very conscientious, extremely self-disciplined, a guy that knew who he was, where he was coming from, and never lost his way. And I'm going to forget somebody, I know. Present kid, DJ Dozier, who has a chance to be a great back. So we've been really blessed with the kinds of running backs we've had. The 1980 season was kind of a turnabout season for us. We had just come off the 79 season. We were disappointed that we were so inconsistent. I felt that I hadn't done a particularly good job of coaching, and so when we went into the 80 season, the only problem I felt we would really have was deciding on a quarterback. And once we got that straightened out, we were a good football team.
Jeff Hostetler and Todd Blacklid shared the quarterbacking duties for the first three games. First came a 54-10 victory over Colgate. Kurt Warner scored the first three touchdowns, and freshman Kevin Bow scored the last one.
Third and one for Penn State. O'Donnell in motion. This is Bow. Oh, he may go 80.
They said he could go.
Then the Lions went to Texas and defeated Texas A&M 25-9. Blocked Aggie punts led to 9 Penn State points.
We then came home and played probably the best team in the country that year, Nebraska. They beat us 21-7. But we were really pleased the way we played most of the game.
Turnovers were the Lions' undoing against Nebraska. Four fumbles lost and three interceptions.
Warner is in a slot to the right.
We gotta get stronger up there.
Intercepted by Sammy Sims. All the way back to the 20-yard line of Penn State, and now the Lions are really in trouble.
Todd Blackledge set up a Penn State score with a pass play on third and one.
Kenny Jackson in motion. Got him, Jackson! At the 5-yard line.
All right, big play, Ray Scott, and that's what you got to do.
But Cornhusker I-back Jarvis Redwine set up a Nebraska score with a 17-yard run. Before a record Beaver Stadium crowd of over 84,000, Nebraska prevailed.
After we played that game, we all felt we had a good football team, even though we had gotten licked. And I think we proved that the next week when we went out and played Missouri before a big crowd, a very vocal Missouri crowd, that had to come from behind to win it.
Defensive halfback Paul Lankford helped the Lions come back. His two interceptions in the third quarter set up two Herb Menhart field goals. On offense, Todd Blackledge made his first start at quarterback, and his passing and running kept Penn State in the game.
In fact, Blackledge on a short down play ran an option play and kept it and ran about 47 yards for the go-ahead touchdown. Todd Blackledge handled the situation. He was the boss. Everybody in the team realized now we've got a quarterback. We've got a guy that can get it done. And from then on in, Blackledge was just a superb quarterback through the rest of 80, 81, and 82.
At Maryland, the Penn State offense didn't get on track until the second half. But then Booker Moore ripped off the longest run of his four-year career.
Booker Moore. He might go.
Good race. He's going to win it, too. They won't catch him.
Touchdown.
Blackledge passed 5 yards to freshman flanker Kenny Jackson. That was the first of many Blackledge to Jackson TD plays over the next three seasons. And Chet Parlavecchio's interception gave the Lions possession in Maryland territory. Syracuse was the next opponent, and with another strong second-half performance, Penn State treated the homecoming fans to a 24-7 victory, featuring plays like this Blackledge to Warner screen pass. The Lions found themselves hanging on in the second half against West Virginia. Penn State had a 10-0 halftime lead, but in the second half, the Mountaineers had field position, starting with a kickoff.
This is Walzak. He was out of bounds already around the... He stepped out of bounds around the 30-yard line, but the officials didn't discover it.
Three plays later, WVU was in Penn State territory.
West Virginia, 3rd and 3, Penn State, 48-yard line. Here's Alexander again. He might go. Pete Harris. He got away from Pete Harris. Out of bounds inside the one. So this game has turned around on one big play. Alexander loses a football. Penn State has it.
But the Lions could not move the ball.
Rochelle snaps it on target. The punt is blocked. This could be a touchdown or a safety. It'll be a safety. West Virginia within an eyelash of a touchdown, but it's squirted away. It will be a safety. Following the safety, Giacomara will punt for Penn State. Newberry and Walker are back deep for West Virginia. This is Newberry, started at the West Virginia 18. Look out.
Well, they're back down there again.
After a penalty, the Mountaineers are on the Penn State 22.
Touchdown! Billy Evans. 11 minutes and 17 seconds left in the third quarter. The Mountaineers have closed it within two. Sinclair's kick will be handled by Warner from the 12. He might go.
I don't believe
88
this.
Yards.
No flags. Well, I'll be a son of a gun.
Penn State was back to a 9-point lead, but even after they added a field goal, the Lions weren't safe. Jeff Hostetler fumbled a snap on the Penn State 34. Eight plays later, Walter Easley ran 9 yards for a touchdown to cut the deficit to 5 points. It was time for an onside kick.
Well, Penn State should have as many people up around that ball as they possibly can. Here it comes.
Here's a short kick. It is loose at the Penn State 48-yard line. Let's see who has it. The officials have not yet signaled. Mountaineer players have.
It hit a Penn State player first and bounced off. Could be any. It's West Virginia's ball.
West Virginia moved to the Penn State 38, but the Lion defense came up with one more big play.
Fake the handoff over the middle. It is intercepted by Giuseppe Harris. And Penn State comes up with the big play.
They faked Alexander, go deep over the middle. Trying to get it to Evans.
Pete Harris.
This time, Pete bounced it back to his younger brother, saying, here, kid, hang on to it.
Now, we'll take an in-depth look at the Harris family.
Athletic excellence is a characteristic of the Harris family. And this excellence has become closely related to the Penn State football tradition.
Giuseppe wanted to be Giuseppe. Piero wanted to be Piero. Franco wanted to be Franco.
Piero Giuseppe, three brothers from a family gifted in athletics, the Harrises of Mount Holly, New Jersey. The name Franco Harris is instantly recognized in sports circles across the nation. Franco came to Penn State as a high school All-American in 1968 and rushed for over 2,000 yards and 24 touchdowns. Professionally, Harris is headed for the Hall of Fame. And by choosing Penn State as his college, Franco started something of a family tradition in a family where being close still means something. Piero comments on what it's like having an older brother like Franco Harris.
It's pretty nice having an older brother like that, you know?
We are, it's not 7 years apart. And when you're younger, that doesn't make a lot of difference. But him being my brother and, you know, like, the way I feel about him, I just want to try to give him as much help and as much direction as I can.
Piero is a junior and starting safety with the Nittany Lions. He talks about his adjustment to Penn State.
It's hard. Like, after practice, you're tired and everything. You don't want to study. But you got to try to budget your time to make the best of it. You lift weights during the off season just to keep your strength up. You always try to run a couple miles a day. Constant running, you know, and keeping active and not sitting around being lazy.
Piero's hard work has paid off. After suffering a broken ankle last year, he has come back to lead the Nittany Lions in interceptions and to continue the Penn State Harris family tradition. The next Harris in line is Giuseppe. He leaves home as the newest member of the Penn State Harris family and packs some very impressive credentials. Giuseppe is a freshman at Penn State. Earning All-State honors in both football and baseball, he was recruited by Arizona State, UCLA, and Ohio State, among others. He even turned down an offer to play professional baseball. In the family tradition, Giuseppe Harris chose Penn State, where he could finally play on the same team with his brother. Why such athletic excellence in one family? Mr. Harris has his own idea.
And start them off, it's about 7, 8 years old. Then the rest of the boys just fall in line and go right on behind them. They follow their brother's footsteps.
How does a mother view her son's relationship with Coach Paterno?
Very proud of my children. He loves my children.
Franco looks back on his years at Penn State.
I blazed the path for my brothers.
The month of November brought three more victories. The Lions' pass defense kept Miami quarterback Jim Kelly off the scoreboard this time around, and Kurt Warner rushed for 146 yards as Penn State beat the Hurricanes 27-12. Against North Carolina State, Warner's backup Joel Coles came off the bench and gained 151 yards in a 21-13 victory. And at Temple, Coach Paterno substituted freely and wore down the Owls 50-7. The Penn State record was now 9-1.
We really put it together and came on strong and went right down the stretch until we played Pitt, the last game of the year, and that was a great Pitt team. Now maybe even better than their 76 and 77 team. Had Hugh Green, Ricky Jackson, and those kids, and we could have won it. We lost 14-9, but late in the game, Kurt Warner had a good chance to get us back in the game, made a great 16-yard run, and fumbled the football deep in the Pittsburgh territory. Then we got another shot, and Blacklish took us on a long drive with the clock running out on us, and got a little bit careless when he was trying to ground the ball and didn't get it out of bounds, and Williamson intercepted it. And that was the end of the football game, but it was a great football game between two excellent football teams. And then, of course, we went out to the Fiesta Bowl, played Ohio State, beat Ohio State. Warner had a great game out there. First play from scrimmage, he ran 64 yards. And we were really starting to put everything together to make a run and having an 81 and 82. If ever there was a season to get a team ready to run for a national championship the following year, the 81 season was it.
The opener at home certainly built the Lions' confidence in their offense, which would average over 38 points through the first five games. Penn State dominated Cincinnati 52-0.
We had great football games that season and played some of the great teams in the country, starting with Nebraska. Out at Nebraska, we won it 30-24. Kurt Warner ran for about 220 yards that game.
It was Todd Blackledge's passing that brought Penn State back to take a halftime lead.
And here he goes again. They're going for the Royal Marble.
Jackson. Touchdown.
Blackledge had a good day, and it was a tough win for us. Warner just was too quick. Too fast for everybody in the football field. And many a time when it looked as if Nebraska had him, he was able to run and make the corner on him, which you don't do very often against a team the caliber of Nebraska. Kurt's played a lot of great games for us. I don't know whether he ever played a better one than that game. I thought he was as good a football player, as good a running back as I've ever seen that day.
The Lions crossed the Nebraska goal line only twice. The margin of victory was Brian Franco's 5 field goals, a school record. The final score, Penn State 30, Nebraska 24. The third game of 1981 was against the Temple Owls.
At the Penn State 41-yard line, first and 10, Temple. Murphy, intercepted by Harry Hamilton.
Blackledge's passes set up the touchdowns as Penn State shut out the visitors 30-0. The Nittany Lions would have shut out their next opponent as well had it not been for a freshman quarterback who came in late in the game.
The thing about the BC game that year is that in the fourth quarter, a little runt came in and started to throw the football, and he was to go on and be the great quarterback of the 80s and be the guy, the football player of the 80s probably, Doug Flutie, and everybody knows what he did for BC football.
But Flutie's heroics weren't enough on this day in 1981. Mike Mead rushed for 107 yards, Kurt Warner for 105, as Penn State defeated Boston College 38-7.
In the Syracuse game of of 81. Warner playing up in the Carrier Dome on artificial turf. His eyes lit up when he saw how fast that field was, and he ended up gaining about 260 yards, and he only didn't play very much. If he had played more, he might have made 400 yards. He was a fantastic back that day, and I remember Ben Schwartzwalder was in the press box, and some people asked him how would Warner compare to Jimmy Brown and Ernie Davis and the great backs, Floyd Little, and the great backs that Coach Schwartzwalder had at Syracuse, and said he made the statement he could play with anybody, and he could.
You hear football coaches talk about backs who can slide. Now watch this. He finds a little hole, gives it a skip step. Now watch him slide. He actually slides and glides out of the tackle to the outside, goes into a high gear. Nice run.
Gain 13 yards. First and 10 at the Penn State 33. Warner again. Oh, what a beautiful runner all the way to the Syracuse 49-yard line.
Well, that's great blocking too, Ray. Watch him break it back over the center now. See that? Big hole. Look at the gaping hole there. Good running again by Warner.
Here it comes again. All the way to the Syracuse 28-yard line. After the Nittany Lions scored for the third time, Penn State leads 21-9. After Penn State recovered a Syracuse fumble, the Lions have the ball. 1 minute, 17 seconds left in the first half. Here comes Warner.
Goodbye.
Touchdown. 69 beautiful yards.
Is he a great one or is he a great one?
Warner's 256 yards rushing on 26 carries that day broke a school record that had stood since 1912. His 341 all-purpose yards also set a new Penn State record. The Lions won 41-16 and afterwards were ranked number one in the nation. Warner set out the next week with a hamstring pull, but backup tailback Jonathan Williams filled in with 140 yards as Penn State beat West Virginia 30-7 to retain the top ranking.
And then we went on to play a tough Miami team. The game we lost, we were undefeated going into that one, and it looked like we might be able to win the national championship in 81.
Penn State squandered its early scoring opportunities. Place kicker Brian Franco, who had been so effective at Nebraska, missed four field goal attempts. The Lions were down 17-0 with less than 12 minutes to play before Blackledge ignited a comeback.
Touchdown.
Touchdown for McCloskey, but a penalty flag is down. A penalty flag is down.
Got to be interference now. I'm questioning on who.
It is against Miami. So Penn State is on the board. Penn State missed a two-point conversion. Penn State trails 17-6. Miami has the ball.
This is the play for Penn State right now. If Miami gets a first down, you can just about write it off.
Third and two. This is Roan. He does not get it.
That was a great tackle.
Super play by Robinson and a fumble, and Penn State, I think, has the football.
And Langford got the fumble. You watch this hit. They talk about Robinson. I said before, he wants it real bad. He's got a lot of tackles. He's got the third leading tackle on the football team from a free safety position.
And there's the ball
there's
in
the
air.
And if Langford got that on a fly, it would be an interesting last 5 or 6 minutes.
Well, it's still going to be interesting because Penn State has it deep in Miami territory.
Penn State now has to put it right back up in the air. Hope they can get a break.
Second down and about nine at the Miami 27. This is Williams.
Got a lot of room.
Touchdown. Now Penn State is back in the football game.
We got to where we were 17-14 and we were on another drive. And we had a chance to win it, and we had a fumble. Jonathan Williams took a little pitch out and wasn't quite right, ready for the pitch out and never got control of it, and we fumbled out that play, and Miami got it, and that was the end of that ball game.
And the end of Penn State's number one ranking. Blackledge did have one last chance with less than 2 minutes to play, but his pass was tipped, and Miami had a 17-14 upset. At North Carolina State, it was another wild game. The Wolfpack had been rushing 10 men on punts, so the Lions made their first use of a play they'd been practicing for 2 years.
Jenkins is the returner, and he's an excellent one. Ken Jenkins. This is a fake. A pass is to Hamilton.
He's gonna, maybe.
Maybe all the way. Touchdown.
Well, I'll be darned.
Was it Ken Kelly, the up man, who threw it?
The up man was 80-something. I think it was Kelly. He hit Hamilton. They fooled North Carolina State completely, and anything can happen in football.
Penn State's punt defense blocked 2 punts in the fourth quarter, resulting in 9 points. The Lions won 22-15. They were back on the right track.
Then we came back and lost Alabama. And, I mean, Alabama really kicked our ears in. For some reason, we weren't quite right. They jumped on us early with some deep passes. They had great speed, and the little kid, Jones, and they hurt us with deep passes early, and we were never able to recover. Couldn't get enough offense together to be able to do the job there.
Lots of time. He's throwing for the end zone, and the defender fell down. Roger Jackson fell down. Touchdown, Alabama.
I'll be darned.
Bear Bryant's team defeated Joe Paterno's team 31-16.
And so we were now where we thought we were going to be a pretty good football team, had a chance at the national championship. We lost those two football games, both to Miami and to Alabama. But again, to the credit of the people on that football team, their character, they came back and beat a fine Notre Dame team, 24-21, again. In the fourth quarter, made a super drive, played really tough football, and was starting now to feel good about themselves again.
It was the defense that started Penn State's fourth quarter comeback this time. Notre Dame had a 4-point lead and was knocking on the door again.
Irish, fourth and inches at the Penn State 3 as they go for the first down or the touchdown. Did not make it. They're going to mark it at the 3.5-yard line. Penn State takes over the football.
The Lions had to punt, but the defense got the ball back.
Howard to the left, working against Langford. Mosley to the right, working against Jackson.
And
here's a big play.
Single coverage on Howard.
Here comes a rush. Gattuso has intercepted. Greg Gattuso has intercepted at the Penn State 18-yard line.
Well, I don't know what a defensive tackle's doing down there, but he's in the right spot.
Number 70, keep your eye on him.
He's going to be at the middle of the screen. Now, why he's going down there,
here comes
the
pressure.
Here he is. That's a tackle. Number 70. I guess they had some kind of a game where he's a great interception.
What hands?
Here's the replay from another angle. This is a defensive tackle, 10 yards downfield, making a great one-handed interception. Look at that, folks.
The pass was intended for Carter.
And this time, the offense moved the ball. Todd Blackledge hit Greg Garrity for 20 yards. John Williams rushed for 13 and later for 24. And Blackledge took the ball into the end zone himself.
Blackledge, touchdown.
Penn State won 24-21. Williams finished with 192 yards.
Our 81 team had a lot of good offensive players. It was really a great offensive team. We had kids like Jonathan Williams, who played in the shadow of Kurt Warner. We played Jonathan at fullback, played him at tailback. When Kurt got hurt and he had to play, and particularly against Notre Dame. He ran for 191 yards against Notre Dame. When you can take a kid who's kind of a backup, and he can go in there and make 191 yards against Notre Dame, you know what kind of people you have. And 81, we had some great offensive people, really. And Jonathan Williams certainly was one of them. He didn't quite get the fanfare that Kurt Warner got, but Jonathan Williams in his own right was a great back.
Now it was the final week of the season, and Pittsburgh was undefeated and number one.
And then we went down to Pitt. Probably one of the greatest turnarounds that I've been involved in. That was Danny Marino's really big year. He was a junior. They were playing really well. We went down there and the score was 14-0, boom. And Marino's going for the next one just before the quarter. He hit two big league touchdown passes and looks like it's gonna be 21-0.
Second down. 7, Pitt at the Penn State 31-yard line. The one set back, DeBartola. Look at the time Marino has. He's throwing for Collins. Is it intercepted? Intercepted. Roger Jackson for a touchback, and Pitt has lost the football, and Penn State will have it at their own 20.
Well, that's the first mistake that Marino made, but I actually think he was trying to throw it out of bounds. He just didn't have enough zip on it. His primary receiver was to the left, was covered. Now he goes deep here. Penn State is in the right coverage. Jackson's behind the receiver, and he catches it before he goes out of bounds.
All right, Blackledge, apparently recovered from that slight ankle injury, comes sprinting into the huddle. 12 and a half minutes left, first half. Pitt leading 14-0 on two Marino touchdown passes.
There.
This is McCluskey.
Tight end.
Down to the 2-yard line, and Blackledge beat the blitz.
That set up Penn State's first score. Later, Pitt threatened again.
Marino shouting instructions to his teammates. Penn State doing some shifting around now on defense.
They're going to go to Collins.
A lot of time.
All right.
Intercepted. This is Robinson.
Now that was a great play. Great play.
And the Pitt intended receiver is really hurt at the goal line.
That's what you got to do. That's Roger Jackson who made the hit. But I tell you, Marino's fantastic. That ball was right on the money. Let's watch this straight drop back action. Watch him drill the ball in there to the receiver. He gets hit as the ball comes to his hands. That was Roger Jackson, made a great hit. And 32 Robinson picks it off. And Penn State now has an opportunity to move closer and closer to the Pitt Panthers.
Second and one after the gain of 9 at the Penn State 39.
Going to try to get Jackson deep, I think. He's got it if he's
Jackson is behind the defenders. He's inside the 10.
And that's what you got to do. And the reason why that worked, Ray, it was done at the right time. Now, this is what I'm talking about, double coverage. You can throw it to double coverage if you get enough time, and you can split the outside-inside receiver. A good pump fake to the left. Very well thrown ball. Jackson is way, way behind him.
So it will be first and goal for Penn State. 2:55 left to play, first half. Barr and Warner, the running backs. A quarterback draw.
Beautiful play. Beautiful play, and it's a touchdown.
It's a touchdown.
And that's what I'm talking about, exciting, wide-open, reckless football. They knew that the Pitt defense was going to fly out of there. Let's watch the play. We got another replay. You got a big quarterback, and he's strong. He takes 4 steps back. 1, 2, 3. Bango. 4. And up he comes, follows his blockers carefully, takes it in for a touchdown. We got some ball game on our hands.
The game was tied at halftime. In the third quarter, Kenny Jackson's receptions gave the lead to Penn State.
And Kenny made some plays in that game that I don't think I've ever seen made before. He caught a ball on the sideline one time, made a fantastic spin as if he were a ballet dancer, and went 40-something yards in the end zone. He beat somebody deep. He jumped and caught the football. He played like a man possessed in the last three quarters. I keep thinking about how fortunate we've been at Penn State. So many of the kids we've had have always played better in the clutch. They've enjoyed having pressure on him. And Kenny would be right up there with the Lydell Mitchells and the other kids that I have always felt would come to the front when you needed them the most. And Kenny was, he was a joy on the sideline. He was a joy on the sideline because no matter how bad things were going, Kenny was always saying, hey, we're going to get it turned around. We're going to get it turned around. This is our game. We only need one play. And Kenny usually was the guy that made the play.
Penn State has now scored 21 unanswered points and leading Pitt 21-14. 9:19 left to play, third quarter. Fake to Warner. This is Jackson, wide open. Nobody there.
Touchdown. What did I tell you? You can't cover him one-on-one.
The Lions kept right on scoring in the fourth quarter. All-American guard Sean Farrell scored the only touchdown of his career when he pounced on a Kurt Warner fumble in the end zone. And the Lions picked off their fourth Dan Marino pass. Safety Mark Robinson lost his shoe, but was still able to outrun the demoralized Pitt offense for a 91-yard interception return.
We ended up winning that football game 48-14. And the last three quarters, we were just a super football team. And that carried over into the Southern Cal game, the Fiesta Bowl, where it was Marcus Allen, who was the Heisman Trophy winner, and we had Kurt Warner. And every time Kurt Warner was in a football game against a really good back, particularly a Heisman Trophy winner in this year and later on in 82 against Herschel Walker, he rose to the occasion and he had about 150, 60 yards that day, and I think we held Allen to about 60 yards that day. And there was no question, on that particular day, Kurt Warner was a better back. And it was a very impressive win for us, 26-10, played tough, hard-nosed football. So we had a great year. We beat a great football team in Pitt, we beat a great football team in Southern Cal, we had beaten a great team in Nebraska earlier in the year. And except for the Alabama game, which we really were not in, we had a shot to beat Miami. The other game we lost, if we hadn't fumbled, we would have. They may have won that championship in 81, but they waited around 82 and then they got it. A lot of schools and a lot of fans, the 79, 80, and 81 seasons, the combination of those three seasons put together would have been great for a lot of places. There were three bowl games involved. Team in 79 that won the Liberty Bowl, 80 and 81 teams that won the Fiesta Bowl against good people, played great football teams. It was an exciting 3 years. I think a very exciting 3 years, but the fact that we lost out on our chance to win a national championship made it a little bit frustrating for some people. Not to me, and I don't think to the coaches or the players, but we lost a game or two that people figured we shouldn't lose. But overall, I think the 79 season obviously was a little bit of a disappointment to us because we came off that 78 season and I wasn't right mentally as a coach. I couldn't quite get that game out of my craw. But the 80 and 81 seasons were great seasons with some great young players coming into the forefront, Blackledge, Warner, and those kinds of Kenny Jackson and those kids, and got themselves in position. Got themselves in position with the tough schedules they had played and the way they had played those tough people to really feel good about their chances to win a national championship in 1982. So it was a very exciting 3 years, and in a lot of ways, I think there was the fans, regardless of the fact there wasn't a national championship involved or an attempt to be or a chance to win a national championship in any one of those 3 years, they still saw some super football and some great, great football players.
So that's it for Great Moments in Penn State Football, Volume 2. For Coach Joe Paterno, I'm Jimmy Cefalo. Thanks and goodbye.